Call the common council member meeting order, who's right to pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everybody, and happy new year. This is our first council meeting for 2017, for January 3rd, due to the holiday. We'll begin with roll call members, please.
Councilman Moore?
Here.
Councilman Redson?
Here.
Councilman Jeffrey?
Here.
Councilman Clemens?
Here.
Councilman Tyrus?
Here.
Councilwoman Sommerman?
Here.
Councilwoman Dreska?
Here.
We have all seven members here, full quorum. First thing on the agenda is the approval of minutes to place a special council meeting on December 19th. It's the council's pleasure.
So moved.
Motion to approve, do we have a second? We have a second. Any discussion of the motion? Additions or corrections or additions to the minutes? Hearing none, all in favor with an eye?
Aye.
Against? The ayes have it, thank you. Reading the agenda, we do have one additional item to add tonight, the approval of 2016 encumbrances. Do we have a motion to add that to the agenda?
So moved.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Discussion of the motion? Hearing none, all in favor with an eye?
Aye.
Against? The ayes have it. And then it'll be listed as number three. Okay, we'll have approval of the manual checks for the end of the 2016 session. Petitions, remonstrates, and public statements. We'll have special recognition by the mayor's office for the employee of the month. Reports from department heads, boards, and committees. We have a couple of those tonight. Under appointments, I believe we'll have an announcement today from the city council. Presentations, we have the American Legion presenting some checks tonight. Number two, Diana Bossa, special events administrator, will present the tour of lights for 2016. We still have deferred business on resolution 2016-09-18R. Under old business ordinance 2016-08-14, salaries for elected officials. New business, we have a sewer rate ordinance 2017-0101. Number two, bond ordinance number 2017-0102. Of course, number three now, the approval of the 2016 encumbrances. One point of order, we can take M as a council and move that to the end and go with new business. We have people that travel a long way here to be in front of the council for the time purposes. Okay, before then, just put the end. Okay. We'll go right then to the approval of the manual checks, and we'll go to Chris.
I looked at the limited number of claims that we had, and we've got it all before you there, so let me see for yourselves. It looks like city business as usual, and I recommend we approve it.
Motion to approve the manual checks as presented. Do we have a second?
So moved.
We have a second. Discussion of the motion? Hearing none, all in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Against? The ayes have it. Thank you, council. Next up is petitions, remonstrates, and public statements. All of that is to come forward and state your full name and address for the record.
What was the form there? I'm sorry.
This is the public petition, remonstrates, and public statements.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
Yeah. I misunderstood them. My name is Bill Alder. I live on Clark Street. Happy New Year to all of you. Just have a couple quick requests. Number one, if the city contact the Chicago Cubs, get them to bring their trophies here. Or have you already done it?
Great idea.
We've been on the phone.
Great. I have thought when the Sox had theirs here, a very good Sox fan told me course, he was proud as heck. Told me, he says, you know, but if the Cubs ever win this thing, the crowd will probably be twice as large. Well, let's see. I think you'll have, if you advertise it, I think you'll have people from quite a ways away.
We've been knocking down all the doors, calling our contacts.
I kind of thought you had. I mean, I assumed, but I wanted to make sure. Secondly, next summer when you're deciding what streets to pave, I would like for you to take a good look at South John Street. It's in pathetic shape. South John. And I'm done. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else? Once, twice, we'll close the public portion tonight. Do a special recognition by the mayor's office and our employees of the month for January 2017. We have three police officers that were nominated by a resident. The resident was pulled over, not pulled over, was pulled over the side of the road. Big difference there. And side of the road with a flat tire. She called for AAA, in which they said it would take approximately an hour or so before anybody could provide assistance. All three officers stopped by to check on the disabled vehicle. They proceeded to help change the flat tire for the resident instead of having to wait. The resident was very appreciative for the assistance of these officers. They provided the care and the concern for somebody who was just passing through the community. So with the resident putting this information in, we want to recognize Corporal Chuck Newman, who's been with the police department for 13 years. Corporal Milay Knezovich has been with the city for 14 years. And our canine officer, Officer Stanko Lurich, has been with the police department for 5 years. So we'd like to bring you guys forward and present these awards to you. I don't think Milay's going to be here tonight, but we'll pass it on to the chief. Chief, you want to come up and thank you for it? Use it real quick. We just ask you if you can. I don't remember that well, but what took place.
Honest with you, I was cutting through the sportsplex to get over to my bank, so I didn't have to fight the traffic on Broadway. Came across a lady, and she was right off of the new entrance on East South Street. Tire was completely shredded. I was off duty. Stopped to check on her. She said she called AAA. Kind of told her she'd be there about an hour, so I could get started on it. And she didn't think she had a spare. Found it in the trunk, and then Officer Gligich and Corporal Knezovich were working, came over, and after I got it started, Knezovich took over, and Gligich helped get the rest of the stuff out. And put the.
So you were off duty when this all took place?
Yes, sir.
It's another example of how our take-home cars continuing to work at 12 points.
All credit goes to Corporal Newman, but Milay and I just told him what a great job he was doing. He was changing the tire, so I was embarrassed, but it was all Corporal Newman.
You know, it's
special. Yeah.
Chief, we can mind if we get a picture. Congratulations.
Thanks, sir.
Everyone,
Okay, we're going to go right into reports of department heads, boards, and committees. And I know that Alex Kupinowski is working with our ordinance committee and did a presentation on the 19th and brought back the work product and presented to the council on a ordinance form.
Thank you, Mayor. That's correct. We have a few ordinances here for the council's consideration tonight. The first being the establishment of a new fund for team building. I know the council just got these there tonight, so just for first reading, tonight only, want the council to take it back and read it. If they deem appropriate, then they can suspend the rules and pass it tonight, but I just want to make sure, because it was, they're only getting it tonight, that there's a thorough reading if that is necessary. The ordinance essentially reads for the team building fund, that the team building fund is established by the council. The purpose is for fostering positive working relationships and goodwill amongst the employees of the city of Crown Point. There's some guidelines that are established for what type of items would be purchased and paid for out of this fund. For example, condolence gifts, greeting cards, employee appreciation banquets, employee team meetings, lunches, admission of city employees to public events, and other items which are deemed appropriate for this fund by the department head, the mayor, the board of works, or the county council. So essentially this ordinance would create the fund. It would authorize the council to budget and appropriate monies into the fund. It establishes those guidelines, what would be appropriate to be paid out of the fund, and then authorizes the basically the departments to use the funds in accordance with this ordinance. And so I'll open it up to questions, and probably Chris kind of spearheaded this one, so I'll open it up to him first, maybe.
Absolutely.
Thank you. It looks tidy, and this one we might want to consider suspending the rules to pass tonight, since this does, you know, just keep our accounting consistent through the entire fiscal year here. The other one can probably wait if you want more time to look at it. Or, I mean, I'm willing to wait if you guys feel you want more time to look at this. Obviously, you've had zero chance to look at this since Ohio.
I'd like to take a look at it before I go.
Yeah.
Okay. Absolutely. And being that we only got authorization on the 19th with the holidays, this is kind of the fastest I could get it. Make sure the wording was stuck.
And Merry Christmas.
Yeah. Mine's not until Saturday. So.
And I did want to mention, reiterate, that this is not an additional. This is kind of a restructuring of monies that were already allocated, right? It was 10% of a promotion city business account that was taken on.
That's correct.
To form this fund.
We initially took 10% just as a starting point, but we basically had two different types of expenses that were being used in the same fund, and we split these out into two different funds now, so that's more clear accounting and more transparent for how we're spending the public's money.
And I know on the 19th, we kind of requested input from any of the department heads that might have, did everybody feel like they were heard or it was?
Yeah, we had a discussion of this at the department head meetings.
Okay.
Greg worked with the staff and took the information that was provided through the ordinance committee, through Alex's office, and it was unanimous across the board through the department heads. This is a good thing, because it really does then provide guidance on how to use that fund, and claim process to the clerk treasurer would be much more simplified because of it.
Thanks for doing this, Chris.
So I guess what we're looking for tonight then is to read over and hold over second reading title.
And I move to hold up.
Do
we have a number?
It's going to be all three. Sorry about that.
You're just doing the one. The other two we can take home and read, is that correct?
We're going to do them all. First reading and then hold over second reading.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mayor, take it.
Make a motion.
Maybe all four. Did you have one earlier that was 03?
You got. That's not an ordinance. This is ordinance number. We have two ordinances tonight. We have the sewer rate ordinance, which is 2017-0101, bond ordinance number 2017-0102. So, Christy, by my math, this would be number three. If you presented it correct.
So, So I'm making a motion to read in title only and hold over for second reading, ordinance number 2017-0103.
Okay, I have a motion on the floor. Do we have a second? Andrew, or? Scott?
There's three of us.
We'll open up for discussion. The motion. Hearing none, all in favor signify by an aye.
Aye.
Yes. And that'll be held over for the next council meeting. So the next one's going to be the ordinance adopting standards for travel expenses, which would be 2017-01-04.
Thank you, Mayor. Essentially, the ordinance adopts a better accounting of the city's expenses, provides transparency within the city government, and establishes standards for travel expenses for city officials, board members, and or employees. The council has determined that the purpose for the adoption is to provide a safe and comfortable business travel for city officials, board members, and employees, ensure the best interests of the cities are safeguarded, maximize cost savings, outlines procedures for reimbursement, ensures proper documentation of travel and expense records for compliance purposes, and clarifies what expenses are reimbursable and not reimbursable. The highlights of this are essentially that there's a maximum travel expense paid in advance or reimbursed, and it's established based on the U.S. General Services Administration standards, which is basically a government administration that adopts standards for travel depending on the place of origin, or place of your destination, I should say. Also allows the ordinance to be revised as the GSA's revised their guidelines and standards. So every year they come out with new per diems or new hotel rates or travel rates for specific locations. The ordinance allows for those guidelines to be revised as well with regard to the city expenses. Exceptions to the GSA may be made on a case-by-case basis with approval by the mayor in writing. So essentially what happens is you may go to Indianapolis for a conference and the GSA says Indianapolis is $99. Good luck finding a hotel in Indianapolis for $99. So the mayor can approve that with proper documentation showing that here's the ones that we've looked at. We cannot find one within the GSA standards. That'll get attached to the approval. So depending if there's different conferences going on or different events that may be totally unrelated, those hotel rates may not be accessible in that area, and the GSA does not reflect that. So the GSA doesn't keep track of what events may be happening in a certain town during a certain date that it would be reflective of that price. So it allows some flexibility there with appropriate documentation. The ordinance would require that the travel would be pre-approved by the mayor or the applicable department head for employees. It also provides for the clerk treasurer's office to distribute a manual check to the city official, board member, or employee at least 48 hours prior to the prior to the travel. That way they're getting their per diem costs paid up front rather than getting them reimbursed in the back end. The GSA also provides for meals and incidental expenses based on the days of travel or where you're traveling to. There's also a provision in the GSA for the calendar days that you're leaving and coming back. You only get reimbursed, or you only get paid 75% of that per diem. That's reflected in the ordinance. We've added language with regard to a travel completion form, which would be attached to the expenses, which would the employee, board member, or official would attest to their business travel and participation in that specific business travel related event. Indicates that alcohol beverages are not reimbursable. Personal travel should not be reimbursable for any additional costs incurred for personal travel. And also has a provision with regard to medical charges, which are incurred during business travel, should not be reimbursable out of this expense. There's a different avenue with regard to the health insurance and the workers' comp where that would be appropriate. And then it has a list of travel expenses which are not reimbursable. We discussed the travel insurance, and I just added some language in there that there may be appropriate times when that travel insurance is necessary, and that would require approval by the mayor as well. And that's based, the basics of that ordinance that's presented tonight.
Any questions?
So I guess I'll answer any questions on it or take any suggestions that the council may have now to
just some background for anyone that might not have been here at the last meeting. The GSA is the federal government's body for creating standards for federal employees, and then of course they offer it to the private sector and to, you know, lower branches of government like us that wish to use it as well. So it's a pretty straightforward resource. You just go in, if you're traveling to a city, you go and type the zip code or the city name, and it'll give you a whole printout page of what are the acceptable hotel rates by month and the expected, based on the cost of the city, what are the meal and incidental reimbursement rates.
This, this document too, if passed by the council, would also be part of our employee ongoing quarterly meetings. We would educate our employees on how to fill out the form, how to pull the information up, how to fill out the forms, you know, test the school that we're attending, so we have the front and the back end of the document being given to the board treasurer, so she has complete audit control of that and staple of accounts and points.
My only question is, in what cases are things going to be reimbursed, and in what cases will things be paid up front? The city clerk writing a check to somebody 48 hours prior to travel?
Typically, that's going to be for meals. Just for meals, because you'll know exactly what you're going to be doing before you go. You'll have to attest it. Now, if you come back and say, for whatever reason, I came home sick a day, or came home one day early, your paperwork will be attested to that, and the refund will be attached to the difference. If not, we assume that you're going to be there for the whole time, because it'll be a formula, like Chris says. If you're going out on the first day, it's 75%. Each full day is 100%. If you return on the last day, it's 75% of what the per diem is for that market area. It's calculated pretty simply. Once that's taken place, the check is cut to the employee for their expenses that are talked about for their breakfast, lunch, and dinners. And that's something we do with, you know, it's easier for the court treasurer's office. It's easier for the employee who, is going down, because typically they pay for that stuff out of their own pocket.
And then they reimburse that for us.
Yes.
And then they bring a receipt back with who spent the meal?
It's based on one person meal, so it's whatever that person is.
Right.
Based on
they
the federal regulation? No. Based on
so
this, they don't have to. Because now you're licensed to do, you may spend a little more on your breakfast or lunch or whatever. It takes away the paperwork process, and it stays within the guidelines of the IRS federal regulations on per diem.
And it discourages them from just overeating, because they have a maximum, and doggone it, they're going to eat that much. As a frequent, I like the way you, the section that the mayor had requested here to have the reimbursement up front, and that does make a lot of sense. As a frequent business traveler, I've been in the situation where you put it on a credit card that comes due immediately, and all of a sudden you have, you know, if I've been traveling all month, that I've got, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars that are due, and they're not going to reimburse me until next month on that. It's never sunk me, but I mean, I can see where that could be a big financial burden on someone that's running a tight budget.
And again, the program that we put out here, is the basics from the GSA. The things we added on it was the test document that you fill out prior and at the back end. So the employees, actually what we attested that what they're saying took place and was true and incredible. So if something down the road, we find out an employee didn't attend the conference, we got paid, then obviously that would turn over to the city attorney, and that would be considered a category 4 on our violation of our inquiry. So those checks and balances would be
you might want to mention too how difficult it is traveling and getting meal expenses with a as a municipality now for profit tax.
That's another good point. I mean, we chased this thing out of dining and testing this, and if you're on the place and you're saying I'm here, I'm a municipal employee, or we've been on the road where we can actually utilize a credit card, and so this wouldn't be something we would necessarily use, but we would, because now we could avoid all that. Is the fact that we have got to ask the vendor or the place of restaurant that we're a municipal employee, we have to take the tax off. And they said, we can't do that. We bring those receipts back, so they work out, well, can you pay the tax? So there's that part goes away as well. And I think that's where the IRS comes in and says, that's now you're within the Berlin game that we're not too concerned about, especially through the, when you get out of the State Board of Accounts. That's good for her. Thank you.
Part of my reason for going to this, too, as you were asking about the receipts, Carol, was that this would eliminate them having to bring back individual receipts for every donut they bought. Just reduces the burden on them to make sure they save all those and on Christy getting all these dumped on her desk.
I'll move to read the title only and let it for second reading 2017-104.
Yes. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion of the motion? Hearing none, all in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Yes. The ayes have it. It'll be set for the next council.
Thank you. Your Honor?
Yes.
Could I have 2 minutes?
Sure.
There's an issue here. Alex works for the Orcas Committee. Now, since we have hired an attorney, the attorney generally takes ordinances for the council. Now, Alex has talked about this, and I want you to stay right there, Alex. I want to get a reading from this council if you're going to stay and work with the ordinance committee, because I've worked on it for 8 years now. Now, I want the council to take and tell me who I'm going to work with.
Nothing has changed.
I'm going to work with Alex, because Alex wanted to hear that, and I told him I would bring it up tonight. Now, is Alex going to stay on the ordinance and utility committee?
That's up to
council?
Mr. Nichols. That's up to Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols has hired Mr. Nichols.
Okay, that's fine. I know Dave has assigned him to us at this time. It does not cost us any money on our budget for what we have to pay Mr. Schuster. Okay? So now, if I want him to know that the council says it's okay for him to do that, because he's talked to me about that.
We didn't hire him. The council didn't hire him. So
yeah.
It's Mr. Nichols hired him. So we don't.
What I'm getting at is he, by the law, is the ordinance guy. Right or wrong, Dave?
He's represents the council. The council does the ordinances. You know, and I don't.
Did Rich Walters?
Rich Walters was very engaged with the ordinance. So, I think what Councilman Clemens is just trying to navigate that at this point, unless he hears something differently, the council's views, because we want to have.
Exactly.
Effort here. That's we're all still very comfortable with the presentations and the leadership that Alex brings to these ordinance and the committee itself, and wants to continue to do that.
May I have 2 minutes since we jumped out of order? I just want to introduce our attorney.
Well, we still have one.
Way ahead of things, Mr. Clemens here.
Well, we're still under the ordinance in the committees, so I think we have one more two to present, so we have done.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, we have one more.
All right. Go ahead, Ed. We'll finish.
So point of order here. Let's finish with this. Let's see if Alex can bring this one away on too. Maybe that'll sway the difference. But this would be ordinance 2017-01-05, and this one should be pretty simple.
Thank you, Mayor. Essentially, if the council will remember, this is a ordinance that will update our city boundaries one more time. We did this back in September. Since that time, since the survey and legal description that we obtained from Plumtucket, at that meeting we've had an annexation that went through the process that finally got recorded over a county, so there's a little bit of property that wasn't included in that prior legal description. So what this ordinance does here tonight is allow us to button that up a little bit and make sure that all of the boundaries of the city are listed within the ordinances and within our code. So this has a little bit on the south side of town.
As long as we didn't accidentally annex somebody, you know,
no,
we're all right.
There's a few pockets out there, but
right.
We'll move to that.
So this just ties up our previous annexation from,
correct.
Was this,
I believe this is Copper Creek was the last one.
Backyards?
Yep, backyards.
Council passed this last
section.
That was back, yeah. So that cleans us up. And this one here, just by code, I mean, you can roll it over or get it done out of the land? I mean, it just died in the eye of the
We already.
Before the annex.
Is it first reading of this?
No, I was just saying you'd have to do the whole thing, but you could suspend the rules and get this one up and down. This one is just mere doing the course of business to get the annexation.
I need to suspend the rules.
We have a motion to suspend the rules. We have a second. All in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Yes. Rules are suspended.
Hold over, do it twice here.
Just to move to adopt.
Move to adopt ordinance number 2017-0105.
Do we have a second?
So moved.
Do we have a discussion of the motion? Hearing none, please call the roll.
Councilman DeBoer?
Yes.
Councilman Redson?
Yes.
Councilman Jeffries?
Yes.
Councilman Fawnin?
Yes.
Councilman Kyrus?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sowerman?
Yes.
Councilwoman Jasper?
Yes.
Ordinance passes 7-0.
To reinstate the rules.
We have a second.
Someone.
All in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Against? The ayes have it.
Councilman still wanting to hear it.
Alex, thank you for that, and those other two will be held over for the next council meeting.
Thank you.
We'll go right into.
Hello.
Oh, we're going to appointments.
We still got another one?
No, this is it. So now we're going to go into the appointments. So let's.
Does that have a bearing on what we're going to say here on that?
Yeah.
It will.
Yes.
All right.
I think that would be the appropriate time. So, divine, what lane East Bay Attorney should be.
Okay.
So, at this time, I'm going to turn over the appointments to our council presidents. Lord, who we announce?
It's been a couple of years now since Mr. Walter resigned as the city council attorney, and I'm after a search and we're proud to announce that attorney Pat Schuster is going to provide that. He's a former assistant city attorney, a former city council person, has a long list of accomplishments in Lake County and in the city of Crown Point, and so we're glad to welcome him to the team. As a second, kind of a second set of legal eyes in a busy legal department, and expressly for questions of the city council. So we're appreciate that he's agreed to be a part of this, and we look forward to working with him. But it does not change what is already in place. We just have an extra opinion. We have somebody to work with us if we have questions on ordinances or points of order or finances, or just like we did with Mr. Walker. But the legal department of the city defines the roles within their own department, so we don't define those roles.
Madam Chairman, what would be, I was talking to Mr. Schuster just before the meeting, what is his rate of pay, and do we have a, are we out of retainer with him, or how are we going to work that?
We will do that. Similar to the way we did with Mr. Walter, we will be retaining him on a monthly basis for 15 hours a month, which will be, I think, well within the scope of what has been a reasonable workload in the past, and should we have a huge annexation or should we have a big turnover or a big project, then we can renegotiate that.
So, but right now, Mr. Schuster, I get it from you, we are going to give you a retainer, and you're going to, when you use that up, we go to the hourly?
That would be my understanding, although I don't think, Joe, I think we set it high enough, you're not going to end up using that.
No, the rate that is set is well within what has been budgeted. In fact, it's well below what's been budgeted for legal fees for the city council. And that actually, no money has been spent in that area since Mr. Walter left.
I remember one year we spent about $15,000, the most I ever spent with Walter, so not even that. That's the reason he had to leave, because he could not make enough money because we didn't give him enough work. So I was just talking to Pat about that, and so Pat was thought that possibly that retainer would help him because he could be working on other things that he could take care of this. So now all the councils in favor of this, I take it. One, two, everybody here.
I am.
How about you?
Sure.
You are.
This
how about you?
This is a council.
Chad?
It's not just a president's appointment.
Yeah,
I mean, as long as we're in line with kind of the pay that we had given Rich, because we haven't really had much discussion on this. I mean, that's okay. I don't know Mr. Schuster really. I mean, I can recognize his face, but yeah, I mean, as long as our pay stays kind of in line with what Rich did.
That's fine. I just want to make sure the council knew that we were all in line on this.
Is there going to be a contract?
That's what I was going to ask next.
Yeah, Dave, I was going to talk to you about that. I can talk to you after the meeting. How you want it.
Either
I do it or have you do it.
We don't normally discuss personnel contracts at a city meeting.
No, we don't.
So,
I'd like to know how we're going to do it.
That's why we're going to do it at a different time and place.
That's all I have. So, Mr. Alex, you can still work with us.
Thank you, sir.
Just want to make sure we're clear on this. It's 15 hours a month for everything. There should be a contract, right? Because we pass all the contracts that we have for our attorneys are approved at the Board of Nursing over the public record. So, are you negotiating with Mr. Schuster now, or you already have that material?
Because of the holidays, some of this discussion has happened when city offices have been closed.
Okay.
So that is why it's going to happen this week. But he was kind enough to show up tonight at our first council meeting, even
so you're
before
still,
he's
you're
being
still
paid.
Negotiating.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That indicated to me that he would draft the document that he would forward.
I know that'd be one of the questions that we get immediately. We can see the contract. That's all. So just to make sure we're all, it won't be one concurrent act because you're still in negotiation. Correct.
He was kind enough to come tonight without being paid. Yes.
Okay.
I've never known us to discuss the specifics at a council meeting of a personnel contract, and that's why I'm a little surprised at the.
At Board of Works, we do it all the time.
At Board of Works, yes. Have we done it at City Council before? I don't remember that.
We do get hired.
Exactly.
Usually one is already here, so.
Do we need a special meeting for next month then for review the contract or not?
We'll need to do an executive session.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Special.
Okay. I want to make sure we're all on the same page and the same rules for both sides, that's all.
Sure. I've been asking.
That's all. I'm not questioning the appointment. I just want to make sure that, you know, that we have it transparent, that's all. I'm not saying it's not. So
that's
why I asked the question.
Welcome back.
It gets easier than this.
Thanks, Mayor.
Okay, we'll go right into presentations. I know the American Legion has been waiting very patiently here. We've been before. Yeah, you have a couple checks, correct?
Yeah. my name is David Dickinson. I'm the commander of the Sons of the American Legion. American Legion Post 20, which of course is over across the street from Jewel. We've got about 800 members over there between the Legion and the Sons of the Legion and the Ladies Auxiliary. So we're like to think that we're pretty strong in the community. And as such, not only do we contribute a lot of our fundraising efforts to the veterans organizations, which is our first priority, we also like to get involved in the community. And I know the Legion has Police Officer of the Year and Fire Person of the Year and all of the other stuff like that. At the Sons of the American Legion, because we hold our turkey shoot in October, and that's our major fundraising event each year, we're able to donate a substantial amount of money to the other projects that I mentioned. And we have what I call our pet project, no pun intended, but really there is, and that is the canine program of both the fire department and the police department. 2 years ago, I was standing here, well actually last year, and the two dogs were here, along with the police officers, and I thought they blew my cover because it was supposed to be a surprise. But I found out in the meantime that they were the employee of the month, and I just got lucky they were here and it worked out real well. So we try and keep it a secret, but not from everybody that needs to know. 2 years ago, we were able to contribute $150 to both programs each. Last year, we were able to contribute $250. This year, we've had a really good turkey shoot year, And both of the respective canine programs are going to get a check for $300 for this year. And I'll start with the Crown Point Fire Rescue Program under Ryan Cusack and the newly shaved Jake and Captain Crane. If you want to come up, I will give you the check. And anybody else you want to bring, bring them with you. And with great pleasure that we were able to present this check to the Crown Point Fire Rescue K-9 program.
Thanks, sir. We appreciate it.
You are quite welcome. And while I'm standing here, Larry, you might as well say. Pete Land, the chief of police there, and if you're, I see one of my little partners back there now with the dog. And this is not planned normally ahead of time, and I'm under instruction not to give.
No, no, he's fine.
He's totally fine. So they told me, I got a reliable source, that if the handler ain't around, you don't want to be around. So, but anyhow, so.
Thank you so much.
You're part of the canine program?
I am, yep.
And
this is my partner. This is Radar.
I think you were one of them that was here. And Mayor, this check will go to the police department canine program.
Thank you very much.
And as an added bonus, any officer, fire department, or police department that's on duty and wants to stop at our annual or our monthly breakfast, breakfast is on us.
Thank you.
And the next one is this Saturday, 7 to 11.
Thank you again, sir. We appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. How about you, Blake? You get an extra biscuit.
Okay, next up is we had a great turnout in a lot of houses this year for our annual tool lights, and Diana is going to go ahead and give a quick presentation and announce our winners. And again, as tradition, we pass out the Clark W. Griswold official Moose mugs for the home that was voted best decorated and by our own people that toured the all the houses on our many, many nights of festivities.
Thank you. So our 2016 Polar Express and Tour of Lights started. We had some honorary houses or neighborhoods. This is Candy Cane Lane, so they're, we always like to include them because they like to do their whole cul-de-sac. We have the Goodman family at 493 South Court Street. They won so many years in a row that they've now become an honorary house. 411 Southeast Street, the Guard family, also another honorary house. So now we get into the actual houses on the tour. 618 Northwest Street, the Richardson family with 714 votes. 301 East 125th Avenue, the Dressel family, 810 votes. 9824 McKinley Street, the Van Forian family at 837 votes. 581 O'Hagan Drive, the Allen family at 965 votes. 1040 Greenbrier Court, the Black family, 998 votes. They were our winner last year. 2170 West 95th Avenue, the McDonald family at 1026 votes. And the winner is 499 South Court Street, the Teodori family, at 1,095 votes.
Yeah, there, it's one, only one fits in each box.
two-thirds of my family's at hockey right now, so my parents are, they've lived in Crumble for 40 years. So I want to bring them in, and my dad's worked here for 40-something years.
A lot of hours there, huh?
She did the decorating, you should call this, I'm here, you know.
Your old box.
Very good, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Everybody that participated, every house, made the tour exceptionally for our families and neighbors, and whether you went on tours or not, we just saw a lot of people driving around the neighborhoods and making slow drive-bys and just recognizing the Christmas spirit that Grand Point displayed, so everybody played a part. We're under L for deferred business, resolution 2016-09-18R. Is this something we're still, so it comes back to us, right? We'll get your new attorney, all that stuff coming together, we, the ordinance committee, all that stuff. Okay.
Still at that stage.
Okay,
yes.
Very good. M, we're moving to the end, and we're going to go right into the lion's share of tonight's meeting. It is the sewer rate. Ordinance 2017-01-01 and the bond ordinance 2017-01-02. We have assembled a team here for the council to hear the entire presentation. And I'm not sure which wants to take the lead on this. And Patty, Mike Miller.
Happy New Year. Patty Zelmer with Ice Miller. The two ordinances that are before you, one is a thicker ordinance that's what we call the bond ordinance, and then I think the other, rather thin, is the rate ordinance. And this all relates to a capital improvement project for This all relates to the capital improvement project that's being pursued for wastewater improvements. And as we discussed the last time we were all together here about a month ago, early December, these projects are being constructed because of a consent decree that's in place, and the city is basically pursuing this timeline that the consent decree lays out for the completion of these improvements, all in an effort to come up with clean water. It's basically projects that folks all over Indiana are doing, and ones that we don't have a ton of choice in because they are ordered by the consent decree. So you've got your team of folks that are working on this, the engineers with Commonwealth. Greg Garitas is serving as your financial advisor. We're serving as bond counsel. And so our role is to provide all the documents that you need to take this from the beginning point to the ending point. And the ending point meaning a closing where funds are received and those funds are then used to pay for this project. And in this particular instance, the city is going to participate in the State Revolving Loan Fund Program, or SRF program. It has been around since the late 80s. It's a very well-run program. It receives federal money. The state receives federal money They leverage that money with state bond issues, and then they use those pots of money to basically provide loans to units like Crown Point and at subsidized interest rates. So it's really the cheapest money in town in terms of financing sewer projects. It is a bond issue, so you still have all the state law requirements that you have to go through, even though the bonds are ultimately sold to the SRF program. Because there's federal money involved, you also have federal requirements that the SRF program has to comply with, and that they make all of its ultimate borrowers comply with. So the bond ordinance is basically the big document that is designed to set out all the terms of the borrowing. And it is a document that is very important to SRF, so we draft it and give them an opportunity to look at it ahead of time. And we actually got this drafted and reviewed back in 2016, and so we know that it's a document that SRF has signed off on. This particular ordinance also approves a document called the Financial Assistance Agreement. That is a SRF written document that actually is executed and delivered at closing. It's designed to incorporate all the federal requirements of the program so that the state of Indiana can show EPA, yes, we're complying with this, this, and this, and we're making all of our borrowers comply with all these federal things, because here it says so in the Financial Assistance Agreement. So the ordinance has language in it that says y'all are approving of the Financial Assistance Agreement, and you authorize the mayor and the clerk treasurer to sign it and deliver it as a closing document. Technically, it should be attached to your bond ordinance, and I'm thinking that maybe what was circulated to folks at the council did not contain the Financial Assistance Agreement. Again, it's just being approved in substantially final form. It's a closing document that's signed at closing, but I thought I would bring a copy so that whoever keeps the official ordinance should say, yep, it's attached to the bond ordinance. So I wanted to get through that housekeeping. The rate ordinance is something that we're starting down this process. It requires two meetings at a minimum. You have to introduce it. After introduction, you then have to have notice that's published and mailed, and then you have a public hearing. After the public hearing, the rate ordinance can be adopted. Because SRF money is involved, and because SRF is a popular program and we want to keep this money available for Crown Point, we're showing SRF that we're working diligently to move quickly to get to a point to be able to close with SRF. And in order to condense, if you will, the time frame that we have, all these steps we have to go through, we thought, well, we could introduce the rate ordinance tonight, even though we don't know the exact cost of the project because bids aren't in yet. So we discussed introducing the rate ordinance with rates that are along the high side, if you will, thinking that once we get to public hearing and ultimate adoption, you will have construction costs in hand, and then Greg's firm would be able to finalize those rates, all of us thinking that they're going to come down a little bit. That's the point of starting the rate ordinance now, just to keep this moving, given that the council only meets once a month, certain things like that. So those are the two ordinances. The rates obviously are the revenues that come in that provide all of the payment for the bond issue. And SRF is very particular that the rates and charges be in place. And Greg's firm has to produce a report basically to show that the revenues produce X amount of dollars that are sufficient to pay these bonds, plus have some left over. It's called coverage. And you have to have that those rates in place in order to participate in the program. So all of these kind of weave together in an effort to get us to the closing point.
And are we at that point this evening where you're asking the council to take action on these ordinances?
Right. For tonight's meeting, we have two different ordinances and two different actions that we're considering. For the rate ordinance, the only thing that can be done by statute is to introduce it and pass it on first reading. And then typically folks discuss, okay, we're also going to have a public hearing, and they direct the clerk treasurer to publish notice, and we will have our public hearing at such and such a date. That's typically all part of the rate ordinance process. With respect to the bond ordinance, you can move forward and, if you choose, suspend the rules and adopt the bond ordinance in one meeting. That you all have just done that, so you know what that process involves. And that particular process, the statutes that apply to that, there's nothing that prohibits adoption in one evening, and it allows the city to then publish another notice that's required under the statutes to get this 20-day objecting period rolling. So it allows the city, again, to move at good speed to show SRF that we're going as quickly as we can to get to the ending.
And then also, if the council were to take action tonight on these ordinances, you would then have the dates for publication in our clerk treasurer's hands by tomorrow for her to send to the various publishing companies for publication of the
I've got the notices done, except for the ordinance numbers, just anticipating that this all might happen. So I went ahead and drafted them, so they're ready.
So Patty, what you're basically in a nutshell here is the proposed timetable that's been shared with the city and has been shared with the council by your office. If we adhere to this recipe, we should be in good shape based on the timetable that you're describing here tonight.
Right. So you all have that timetable, so that's helpful to know. So the one thing I did learn tonight in talking with Dave is that the Crown Point Star might not really be our paper anymore. So I guess my solution is that we go ahead and use the Crown Point Star and also one other paper that's published in Lake County with general circulation in the city. And that will cover all our bases.
I'm
going to
agree with that. Christy and I have talked about that.
Okay.
I've talked to Mr. Duffy, and the mayor's gotten recent information on our situation with the DLGF regarding the publications, and our original thoughts were valid and good. But in order not to rock anybody's boat, so to say, the publication in the Star and any one of the other local newspapers, general circulation throughout the county, would be recommended.
So, you have a big document in front of you, and then you have a rate ordinance in front of you, and I can answer any questions you might have of me at this point.
No, I was just going to say publication these days. Facebook is probably the
I'm sure everybody's going to know if you post them there.
So what you need tonight is, one, everyone was given the wastewater bond ordinance booklet here. The recommendation is based on this going to the utilities committee, came up in the utilities committee, was the schedule that was provided to everybody. You guys produced and approved that to the council. We did provide that to the council, that timetable. For appropriate direction. We didn't get anything back to object to that. That information was shared with the legal team to share. So the document's could be prepared in anticipation, not to assume, but in case it does go through, like the timetable says, we're prepared to hit the next milestone after January 3rd, by starting January 4th.
And about the document you're speaking of is the bond ordinance number 2017-01-02.
So if we want to do that first and discuss that, I'll pre-present that to the council. You have that booklet in front of you here. If there's any questions of the bond ordinance themselves, we do have professional people in the audience here that prepare this. They can answer your questions accordingly.
I had a question. I've read this three times. And I'm assuming you've read it more than that. And is it pretty standard as far as when it got confusing to me was when somebody else bought the bond, what if we exchanged the bond and transferred the bond as the cost of the city, but if this guy buys the bond, it just was so complex to me as far as
transfer registration.
And so I just want to feel comfortable that somebody that obviously Ice Miller, Greg, that clearly knows what's going on, feels this is acceptable, Dave, as far as following the rules, regulations, we've got something that we're following, because I try to
follow this. What I would say the most up-to-date provisions that are in existence, and I know it's makes your head spin sometimes,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
No one envisions this bond changing hands, but you have to provide for the maybe.
As a possibility. And that's kind of how it read. If this happened, it was like covering all the possibilities. And then I just had one question as far as the bidding process. The bids are submitted. I'm assuming they're closed. And are they open to Public Works, or where are those bids open to?
For construction bids?
Yeah. For
I presume it's Board of Works.
Okay, so it's.
Give a lay of the land on that. It's your big place.
We have a recommended advertisement that meets the state revolving loan funds approval. And at that advertisement, we have two advertisements. We have a pre-construction meeting, and then we have a date and time in which bids are due, and we identify where we're going to open those bids. Typically, it's at a special meeting, or it's at the Board of Public Works meeting, or if bids are open, we're allowed.
And it looks like it's $7 million topped off with $10 million. So if somebody's bid was low and they got it, but all of a sudden they underbid it and the project costs more, we're not on the hook for anything more. They have to stay to that bid. Is that correct?
When the bids are submitted, those bids are held for 180 days. So they have to honor the bids and they submit a bid bond in order to ensure that.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Well, I think with Carol, that was a good question, Carol. A lot of times these cost overruns on these projects, that's what you were saying. If it comes in and we want the $7 million so out, and the cost overrun, when, what happens? Of the total project. Say it doesn't come in, it says not to exceed here, but if it does exceed, what do we do?
If it exceeds, then we determine whether or not we rebid the project because the bid environment was such that we didn't get competitive bids. Or we determine if bids are acceptable based upon the environment, and then we have to start this process over if we exceed the maximum. Is that correct statement, right?
Or we could cash fund it.
You got to remember, Council, on this portion here versus the water side, we're under a judicial mandate, so we're adhering to the recipe to make sure that we're in compliance to the finish line here. So the things that have been put in here, and based on Al's experience with Commonwealth through the vendors that he uses when we've been on this project, again, it's open to anybody. The standard cost that's out there has been pretty much calculated what we need to do to finish. So we know what the cost of lining the pipes are, the cost of the other things that's going to make the Clean Water Act be more here, keeping the ditches clean. So they've got a pretty good idea. They've been working on this for about 8 months on this bid package. So they've got, if they miss one or two things, it's not going to be something that's going to make it go up 10%.
That's what my, like Bob said, that was my concern, is that somebody underbids it, gets the bid, and then all of a sudden, oh gosh, we should have bid a lot higher, now what are we going to do, and you know, all that kind of stuff. So your packet is tight that you give them, so they can pretty much know realistically what it would cost them, that you're saying.
Correct. We should have several bids, and they should all be within relative reasonable range of
rescue that house.
So the scope on this project is not up for discussion because of the federal mandate, so all we don't really have a lot to discuss.
Our hands are tied. This is the last part. You remember the total project cost initially was going to be around $36 million. And this is all said and done. We've done it with cash on hand, we've done it with grants, we've done it with other projects that have scored as well to eliminate some of those milestones. Items work very well with us in Commonwealth to adjust our schedule. I think it's set a new path of how to get to the finish line without the first recipe for success that was put back in 2007. And, but this is the last leg that we've carried the torch up to the first 75%.
What is the chair seeking?
Seeking for a suspension of rules on this portion.
I move to suspend the rules.
Second.
I'll second. Okay, Chris. All in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Against? The rules are suspended. And we're looking for the adoption of ordinance 2017-0102.
So I move to adopt.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion of the motion? Hearing none, please call the roll.
Yes.
Councilman Brechtman.
Yes.
Councilman Jeffries.
Yes.
Councilman Clemens.
Yes.
Councilman Tyler.
Yes.
Councilwoman Sauerman.
Yes.
Councilwoman Jasper.
Yes.
The ordinance passes 7-0. We have a motion to reinstate the rules.
So moved.
Who made that motion?
Bobby. Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Yes, the rules are being stated. And now what you have in front of you is the rain ordinance, and that would be 2017-0101. Again, this is being advertised high based on the information that we've brought from Commonwealth and Greg Garitas, that if these are put in place when the application goes forward, we can begin to do the adoption of the public notices. At the final conclusion, we can bring it back down to a more overall level that's going to be more geared to the bid process. Mr. Garitas is here to kind of explain where he came up with these numbers, and we'll let Greg give a presentation of the rate of finalists.
Thank you, and my name is Greg Garitas, President of Financial Solutions Group. I've been a financial advisor in the city for many years. You have what we've been doing, and I told you in the work session, we had our first report in July, we had our second report in October, and what we'll have is our final report when three main ingredients are put into the mixing bowl. And the three main ingredients that are put in is the bid cost of the project, okay, and that will ascertain the exact amount of funds that we will need. The second component will be the interest rate, and actually that was semi-set here tonight almost by the SRF. It'll be 221 plus or minus, and hopefully minus the green project, so Al knows, and that could reduce it to 2%, and we would have a flat 2% interest rate. Al knows to go down and keep saying this is as green as can be, and so if that happens and it's all qualified, then we'll have that one solidified. And then the third ingredient is when Christy, and I'm hoping to hear this any minute, when she slams that big book shut downstairs, the financial statements, and we pop out the 2016 final financial statements on the wastewater utility, we'll update the report, so we'll have the three main ingredients, which is the interest rate, the most updated financial condition of the wastewater utility, and then the actual project cost. Okay, so we've got one out of three that are completed at this point, and we'll be waiting for the final two. So that's why we're starting with the agreed number that I talked about in the workshop, and we're hoping it will come down. I will say again, you know, that all those things have to come together. We don't want to be too skinny because we know you have increases in the future, and I'll take those into account but we also have some savings, as we've heard from the NIPSCO and some things like that. So stay tuned, it'll all come together at the end, and then we'll have the final version. Questions on that?
Questions on the page two of the rate structure, if anybody has any questions.
I guess, Andrew, it's like we're closing a loop, you know, and you're used to it. All those things have to come together.
All the same time.
Yeah.
So it looks like a 25% increase in the rates?
Yes, sir, it is.
When you figured this out, by the end of the term here, given all the other loans expiring and stuff, what effect did you predict it would have on the reserves? Is this just to maintain the reserves at the current levels, or is this building them?
Well, again, let's define our reserves, because in the wastewater utility, they're simple. First one is a debt reserve, which stays there for the life of the bond issue. Okay, and that's a reserve in the event something happened to the wastewater utility and there was not sufficient money to pay the debt service. Okay? That's one reserve, and that's one reserve that's required. Second reserve, as I would call it, would be the improvement reserve. And that is what we're trying to do, is maintain that reserve. We will be, as we move forward, we'll be introducing one under other ordinance, will be the connection fee and the miscellaneous fee ordinance, once we get the actual cost of the project. And that has always helped our reserve. But I expect the connection fee that we'll present to you could be $2,500 to $3,000. And that will be a connection for new connections, not current. But we want to update that once we get the actual cost. We weren't trying to use a 30%er on that, because that makes no sense. So what we're going to do is have that. And so, Chris, what the hope is, that the general or the improvement reserve will stay the same, but remember, there's ebbs and tides, and the, you know, that is caused by what breaks at the wastewater treatment plant. And so sometimes you have to spend a little more money in one year. That's why, as you know, what we recommend is we always do a brief review, a minimal review each and every year, keep you updated, so that hopefully after this project, we can kind of stay in the single digit increases if needed in the future. And that would be the plan that I would hope that you would embrace.
Well, I dug through all the paperwork here, and I might be missing some numbers here, because obviously I don't have the year-end numbers for this year yet. But I had it showing that at a 25% one-time increase for 2017, that by the end of the 2036, when the bond term will expire, that we'll have accumulated an additional about $7 million even, our reserve there.
That's, Chris, that's a great calculation, but really, you're shooting way in the dark, okay? Because there's so much that happens to a wastewater utility. It's falling apart under the ground every day. And I applaud you for making that calculation. I can almost guarantee you it will be wrong, okay? Because I've been doing this for 25 years. Even I can't do that. But, you know, that would be fabulous. Matter of fact, we can have a rebate then in 36. But, you know, I don't think that will happen. So I wouldn't want to make the public think, oh, great, you know, at least the really young ones, that we're going to get our rebate in 36. But, well, you know, the object there is just maintaining.
I didn't figure in any annual increase based on inflation for the expenses, which obviously that's not a good assumption. That seems to be what a lot of this has been based on. Where I'm coming from here was, we've heard a lot of, the one comment we have heard is that, you know, people understand that this needs to be done, and, you know, our hands are tied, and frankly, it's a good idea to fix it so we don't have, you know, sewage dumping over every time it rains too hard. But they asked if we could possibly spread the increase out over multiple years instead of all at once, just so to soften the burden on those, especially those on a fixed income. So I was just trying to put the numbers together just so I could make some recommendations in that regard.
Sure. And as you know, I addressed the phase-in at the workshop. And the issue there is, you heard Patty tonight, SRF wants the rates that are to be in effect before they'll loan you the money, kind of like Andrew and the bank. And they want that in place so that you can say, I'm going to be able to pay my mortgage back, you know, before they'll loan you the money. So it is the it is the requirement of the low interest loan program that we're involved. And rightfully so.
But is it a requirement that we set today that we're going to increase, say, 11.8% this year and 11.8% next year? I mean, would that be considered having it in place, or do they mean they want people to be paying it already before they
close? Well, the debt service will kick in fairly quickly. So it is my understanding it's at the time you enter into the debt. So,
it depends on how the debt is structured. This bond issue is going to have principal payable every year, annually.
Yeah.
Annual principal, semi-annual interest. So that, you have basically, what's your annual debt service roughly, okay? And then you've got all these other bond issues that are also payable from sewage works revenues, okay? So you look at total debt service, and they want to see rates and charges. They're going to generate X amount of dollars in 2017, in 2018, in 2019. He's got to project those revenues forward and compare it to the aggregate debt service, including the new bond issue and all the outstanding bond issues. And there has to be at least 1.25 coverage. It's a rule that they will not bend on. I cannot speak to any of whether the 25% is too much or whether a phase-in would work, but that's the sort of test we're looking at.
And just my preliminary numbers I did here, and it's like just looking at the short term here, obviously the long term is going to be wrong, that we would, our reserve would drop by about $500,000 in the first year. We'd recover that by about 2025. We'd be back in the positive on that. I know Christy sounds like that was not something we wanted to be dipping into our reserve fund there, especially.
Chris, if you'd be willing to even email those to me and look at them before we get to the final, I'll be sure and take a look at them.
Thank you.
Sure.
Question.
Yes.
I can't let you get away without saying something.
Wouldn't be right, Bob.
When I came on in 2008, I came on with this administration, and me and Dave had talks of utilities since I've been the utility chairman for the 8 years. And would it have been a wise thing for us at the time to take and increase this without the bond, to increase it gradually so we wouldn't have to have a big increase down at this end?
And we're struggling with that in the water, Bob, when we come
yes.
to the water. And the key was, remember what we were trying to do in the wastewater is we actually entered into some debts with that access that Chris had kind of alleged that we will have in the future. And so that allowed us to address this $36 million without any rate increases. So
exactly.
We were, you know, at that time we could have said, hey, we need a rate increase, and it might be, well, why do we need a rate increase? Well, because we know something else is coming later on, okay? But what we did is we were able to use those reserves and do another bond issue. And that's what I guess I caution Chris is, I know, sitting here today, you'll have another bond issue of some sort.
Sure.
Because all those pipes underground. And so, you know, the probability is very, very high. And what we've been able to do, I guess, is give them relief for as long as we could, Bob, but the relief can't occur. Could we have had 5% each and every year? Yes. Were we necessarily able to justify it? No, we had reserves. But and we don't know what the final outcome is going to be until the engineers do all their studies, testing and discussing with IDEM, and get down to final numbers. So there is always two ways to get there. But you know, some choose it periodically, and we gave you updates along the way, and at that point in time we didn't recommend it. But there's always two ways to get there. That's not the way this is ended up. But we've gotten a lot done with the money that we were taking in, and we were able to do those bond issues that you see in your rate report without an increase.
See, Chris, that's what, when you have your meetings with the people come in, those things that they can think about and give them a reason, then you don't have too much flashback on it. That's what I wanted you to say.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And you know, that will be planning in the future, how we'll want to keep an eye on it. You know, and if Chris projections turn out, maybe we won't need another increase in the future. But we'll want to stay up on it.
Will I see you in 8 years from now?
Maybe. If the council and the mayor decide yes, then yes.
So, Greg, are you asking them in the review of ordinance 2017-0101 to take the advice that you've given this evening and to move this along and put this in place this evening?
Yes, well, not put it in place, but yes, I am advising, and I believe it's proper to give it first reading so that we may proceed along the timeline that Ice Miller put together. Yep. And keep working with the state of Indiana, have the two other ingredients come together, and then present the final outcome to council, which will be then the final approval.
That you're coordinating with Patty and...
Yes, sir. Very much so.
So we're not approving a rate or anything, just first reading.
First reading.
Approving the rate structure, it's not your first reading, but that's negotiable as we get the second.
Absolutely. Yeah, this is what we tried to, the course we tried to plan back in November and December.
I'm going to move to read and title and hold over for second reading 2017-101.
We have a motion on the floor, we have a second. Any discussion of the motion? Hearing none. All in favor with an aye?
Aye.
Against? The ayes have it. So passing from the hold for second reading. So now, is it safe to say that the proposed timetable is still in play? January 4th will be the next target date. That's for you guys.
If the timetable is acceptable, that would be a point of discussion for tonight, I guess. Because there is built into this timetable a special meeting on February 22 because the regular meeting will occur at a time that'll be before bids will be in. Correct? Right. So we won't have all the ingredients for Greg's rates to become finalized before your next February meeting. So would it be acceptable to conduct a special meeting? And I suppose you all can decide that later. However, in order to publish the notice of when you're going to have a public hearing, we really do need to decide that within the next few days.
Okay. You just got an updated one from you today, correct?
This was distributed.
This one changed from the one
it's
we
the
at.
Same. It should be the same.
There's a couple days that are different now. So
I'll show you what I'm looking at.
Because we have two different ones up here. The one I mailed to the emails to the council. This is the one that was emailed me and I shared.
I don't know what the other council people have. The timetables?
The timetable we have in front of here is slightly changed. A lot of it's administratively through Ice Miller, FSG, and the Quick Treasure, make sure everything's done. But the important date that you guys will have to look at is February 22nd. February 22nd for a council meeting.
What time are we doing?
Council can meet that day, I'd imagine earlier the better, 6:30?
I know already, I'm not the country.
unless it's a...
I think I can, I mean, if my schedule stays like it is now, but you know, it's, I never know from week to week, then I should be able to make six, but...
Why don't you just 6:30?
Okay.
6:30, 6:30. Obviously, you got to have this because March 1st is a huge date that has, so...
Yeah, we need to do it before March 1st.
Yes, so March 20th.
I was good on the 15th.
But you're not on the 22nd.
I can do the...
15th's too early, right?
It's too early.
Based on what we expect bids to roll in, yeah.
That's important to have that information, but we need that.
So your recommendation is adoption of the timetable that was sent today. Adoption of the timetable.
Yeah, Monday the day.
Right, adoption would occur at the conclusion of the public hearing.
Would the 27th work? Monday the 27th?
I think it would.
Mondays are generally better for this body up here because Mondays...
That's the city meeting night.
Yeah.
That would give us a little breathing room if there's something on the bids that we don't like.
Well, that's too bad.
If we can help you guys, that's great.
Right. We'll help you if you help
us. Perfect. Patty, does that work for you?
Yeah.
It does.
It works.
Okay.
So we're going to say Feb 27.
Is it 27th here then?
Yes,
now, I know. Is that the 4th?
Sorry. Yeah, that's the
4th. There's a BZA at 7 o'clock.
So it shouldn't take us long.
No.
So 6:30.
6:30 is good. 6:30 we should be good.
6:30 to 27.
That gives Jan the way. It is all about Jan.
That's the one you like that.
Make sure that makes the minutes. It's all about Jan.
Good then?
Okay, we will make sure and get with Dave and Christy to get notices published appropriately.
We've come to the ball back of your rafters. Greg, you good?
Yes, sir.
Al?
Just informational. After tonight's meeting, tomorrow I'll forward the mayor's office paperwork. He signs that. He sends it to the State Revolving Loan Fund. Requesting permission to go out to bid. So that's
perfect. And are we getting our stack in order with SRF and the
correct.
Just a question, Al. I mean, I don't know if it's you or Greg, but I brought this up at the utility meeting. Is any of the stuff that we have to do to stay in compliance, is any of that, can stormwater money be used for that, or does it all have to come from the sewer side? Because it's a separation of storm.
Yeah, well, if Al used the word storm, then yes. and you know, that, you know, if we had an overrun, that might be a way of doing that. And I can further, again, when Christy slams the great book shut for the stormwater utility, I can look at that possibility. I know the requirements on the stormwater were pretty aggressive, but. Chad, I'd be more than happy to look.
I think where Chad's leading with that is there could be other people getting a better fair share, which would relieve the burden of a
residential side. Yeah.
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 So we're not sitting there to carry that somewhere down the road here.
Even in our ordinance, I mean, from when was it, 08 even says,
I don't
do an analysis on it that we just never have gotten, you know.
I don't think I've seen a 5-year capital improvement plan from anyone on the stormwater. And that would be a critical ingredient if we could put that together in the next, you know, couple of weeks. That would be nice to have, because without that, I'm shooting in the dark with my guidance. Okay? We really need that 5-year capital improvement plan, and that's always been on our radars for it, but I don't think we've had an updated one since Mr. Miles had left that I know of.
Scotty's aware of that, he's working on it.
Okay, perfect. So if we can get that, then that would give us a little better roadmap. point.
Thank you.
Thank you. And just for Christie's standpoint, for the council, this is a draw bond. I don't know if that was explained, but you won't get all the money up front. It'll be one where we'll submit documents and things like that. So the treasurer's office will, I don't think they've ever done one of this, the new staff, so I'll be helping them through the process that takes a little bit. So we'll work through it.
Okay, number three, we need the approval on the 2016 encumbrances that Christie has provided to council.
And Chris, are you for those are encumbrances?
Funds that are covered out of line items within certain departments
for December.
For use in the next this calendar year for projects that are approved in the budget. So whether the police car, there's extra money so with police car, tires, parks department for a park, things that were already in the budget and things in the work. Every one of those occurrences, per Christie through State Board of Accounts has an appropriate contract. Or even appropriate uses. There's no blanket uses just for keeping in case I need to buy something. So there's an appropriate contract and or a dollar amount that accompanies those other companies. What's the total?
Yes.
It's going to be the second to last.
Yeah, I'm sorry, it's not. It says page two at the top.
Second page to last, three quarters way down, 038. It's the city crown point. Is that the cumulative total of that category? $196,000.
What is 038? I don't have my little question sheet.
I'm not sure. I don't have just me either.
just caught my head. It's a big one, another thing for your description.
That's what the
chicken for the seniors.
Cool. The VH. Right.
So yeah, this is the Joel. This is the Joel. This is the Joel.
There's a summer.
Everything else says.
That is the total fund of the company.
Or the city.
Yeah, because if you look right down underneath it, it says, okay, for 038 versus 196,337.80 expenses, you look underneath total fund encumbered amount. That's the total encumbered funds for all of those going up.
So 038 is not a separate fund? Because none of the, I don't think. This is a total of this, and goes to this.
Yeah, but see, like, the police department is, you guys are like, 040. You guys are 40 dash, so even that's not even going, like, this is the police department, you're flipping here. That's not even matching, so I don't know if these funds series are going to match to what she's putting out here. Does that follow? I mean, these are.
Is that not possible?
No. Because they're all associated with the fund account. Just not fund, we're funded. It's us. 13 is engineering. 14 is Board of Works. 50 is the fire department. That's parks.
So it doesn't look like a total. It's just
Dave, can we approve it next month once we get more of a breakdown? What is it?
Well, it's just that one fund series. Everything else is.
Yeah, but it's a large number.
It's not one fund.
It's not.
See how this is starting to total up. They're ready to recover. The wizard expects it. It was all sheet for me. So carry the 195, 6. Is that for the ambulance? The non-reverting fund that's approved for the funding for the ambulance. You guys program that money.
So 20 is the fire department?
That's in the non-reverting fund. Okay. Is it the ambulance?
These are all 20. These are all 20. This is the fire department. So is that a fire department?
Can we get checkbook? Christy, you got the checkbook with you?
No. Wait, what do you
mean? We're still working with that. We want to know what 038-20-3700 is.
Like we figured out 40 is the police department.
Is that there?
Yeah, the.
Yeah,
okay.
Gotcha.
Thank you, Diana. Thank you, Sachi.
What is it?
That's the riverboat. That's the riverboat.
Oh.
This whole department.
We have that's for the box.
Possibly should be adjusted in the, yeah, should say, or chosen. Yeah, the financial expenses or something.
All right, that's the riverboat.
Thank you.
We never, we don't get in that front a lot, so we better just sit down for a while.
It won't even jump out.
It won't now.
Yeah.
Did we lose Dave?
Yeah.
I was under the impression, I was told by Julie that you reviewed this today, this afternoon, when we were in the office.
Yeah, I don't, no, I got the one-page one, the,
This is check, this.
This one, okay. So you didn't see the encumbered?
No, I said they'd bring that to the meeting.
Okay.
So.
So we've gone through this, and we sat down with each department head, and we carried back, because we didn't want to liquidate their, like, we don't have it, we keep money back. So these are things that have been sat down with the department heads through Greg and I, and trust me, there was a lot that we said, you know, to do by next year. But we knew that if there's piecemeal that had to get in and use for, we definitely allowed it to move forward. So Mr. Garitas has been very good with us. Let us know that we try to carry over as much as we can, and we try with the tax caps and stuff like that to bridge both sides so we keep operations moving forward. So these numbers here shouldn't be intimidating at all. We just want to throw some business that we've done all year long with our departments. And again, you have another look at it. All these encumbered funds are going to be carried over. They still need to be through a purchase order and go through the claims process. Legitimacy as it goes forward, so we still have another bite at the apple. Yes.
I move that we approve these.
The list of encumbrances is presented.
As presented.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. Discussion of the motion. Hearing none, all fair with aye.
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 Yes. Thank you. Now we're going to go to the old business. Ordinance 2016-08-14, salaries for officials. And turn this over. I see you put the agenda, so see if you have anything.
This is being brought up more as a point of discussion and procedure than anything else. I take fault with the way things were handled. I missed a meeting in December because of some travel. There were some papers that were not consistent within packets for all of the council people at the same time. I think some older copies of things have been put in instead of new. We were handed some things at the very last minute. Anyway, we would like to speak to the procedure. For the purpose of transparency, we would like to speak to the procedure of a first reading happening, a change happening without extra discussion beyond what has been talked about publicly, and then showing up at the next meeting for second reading. We felt like there was nobody did anything on purpose. I take blame. I think the council has some culpability here, but it was there was some things spoken of under first reading. There were changes made kind of in an inter-office way. And it was presented to us at the council level, and we would like that not to happen anymore. At some way, and the attorneys may need to speak into this, when we go from first to second reading, anything that is changed, if we talk about something at first reading and say, well, we'd like this wording change, or the mayor says, I see this, or one of the attorneys says this needs to happen, then it makes sense to make that change between readings. However, there have been some things that have been changed without public discussion. And although it has been done that way a lot over many years and many administrations, I would like to bring up as a point of discussion that we make sure that no longer happens, that a change doesn't go from one office to another without it showing up at a public meeting. And the old salary, the salary ordinance that we passed already, that now we've gotten, that cannot be changed, it's in place for 2017, is procedurally just got messy. Not all of the council people had the same information at the same time, and then when we got to the meeting and asked about changes, they were not discussed. And then it went ahead and got passed, and that is, I take responsibility for not reading it more carefully. But we would like to make sure that doesn't happen, just that we all end up on the same page and that everything is discussed with transparency. Not that anybody was trying to cover anything up in the past, I want to make sure it looks like that, but just that we go out of our way to be, you know, as public with any changes that are made from any legislation or any resolution from one piece to another or from one meeting to another. I would like to ask specifically what would help me in as a part-time city employee, that anytime there's a change made from one piece of legislation to another, if in the clerk treasurer's office it could be highlighted, literally with a highlighter, or with red ink or with something, whatever is easiest, that we would, so that when I look at a 16-page document for the second or the third or the fourth time, I can quickly see whatever change has been made. And I'm saying this with some input from other council people as well. So we would like that to happen. Certainly the truth is oftentimes we don't get these until things were much better this month, but we've had some post office issues, we've had some delivery issues, and not all of us are getting these before the day of the meeting. And there is no way that on a day that many people are working full time that they can sit and read 30 or 40 pages of documents within the hour and a half after work. So we need some more focused indication of changes, if that would be possible. That would be excellent. That would be excellent. So I just wanted to say that. And then any other council people who want to speak into that, I know there have been one or two of us have discussed this. So,
well, my understanding of civics now, the attorneys here can, you know, correct me on this, is that when we read something, you know, in a public setting, that, and if we're going to make any changes before the second reading, that it's supposed to be done by motion in the public meeting and not done, you know, via email or, you know, calling the clerk treasurer and say, hey, change this, you know, on the side.
It should come back to the first hearing, first reading again.
Isn't that why we make motions on the floor here?
I think to address the situation here is we had meetings on August 18th, September 6th, September 20th, and October 3rd. In the seven-member body that was elected up here, there was a different setting of people up here in each of those meetings, and there was a consistency of everybody being here. Okay? So whether information was heard verbally through the process or not read through changes, everything that's been presented through the budget through my 9 years here has followed the same process and has not unilaterally made a change without this council being known about it. From August 18th from the workshop, everything was introduced, everything was put in September 6th reading, everything has been confirmed through when we do those changes, just like with Christie, through what I did with Patty. If there was changes amongst the group here, it was collectively put in a laundry list of things to make sure that was added to it. So everything that you've read, everything you've seen, went through the process of transparency. Now, not everybody was at one of those meetings, okay? And if highlighting those things, if you're not here, makes it more consistent, so that way it is a broader scope of things being looked at. When there are changes, because there's a lot of numbers being talked about. Everything's been videotaped, everything's minutes, and adding that extra layer is what the council needs to make sure, because if you're not here, you missed something, or there was something going on that you didn't catch, that will be designed that way for you. Make sure those things internally don't happen. But I can attest to you, the fact that the process that was done for this entire thing across the board was done, and everything was discussed in a public setting and was announced in a public meeting. So there was no internal things after the first reading changes. It was discussed in the process that we've become accustomed to through the last 9 years.
Well, I think with me, when, and it could be my mistake, but when you talk elected official for salary paid for meetings, it's never been assigned to anything but the council people that are on committees. So I think when, after all this time, we've never paid that extra to full-time people, I think that was the concern, and I did not pick up on that, nor did other council members. So I think that's where we maybe assumed and assume wrongly that when you say elected official, it's always been the council and people who are part-time serve on committees, not full-time people who have day jobs.
The ordinance then needs to be relooked, because the ordinance doesn't even specify that you get paid. It just says elected officials and anybody listed on here. So whether it's you submit a board or me doing an appointment for, I can appoint Ken Jeffers to the Board of Works, he would be, based on this ordinance, allowed to be compensated for a meeting outside his elected official abilities. The ordinance itself reads, the elected officials in the city of Crown Point, and then when it goes to the boards and commissions, it's strictly before this year. Years, I'm talking about years past, from last year and beyond. Strictly, if you were on a Board of Works, Plan Commission, BZA, redevelopment, you were paid for attending those meetings. It didn't say.
No, redevelopment councilman never was paid until this year.
Until 2 years ago. We added it to it, but it doesn't say a BZA member that's on a council. That's
right.
A council. It doesn't
when
say.
When you talk elected officials, we voted specifically to the council that sat on these meetings.
Not by ordinance.
Maybe by ordinance, but we had a separate vote that gave those people.
My point is, maybe the whole ordinance needs to be looked at.
Well, right. So I think that slipped by, and I think that was.
Nobody tried to slip it in.
Well, I don't mean poor choice of words, but then I think that's where the confusion is. I kept thinking elected official in the past would approve it for a council. We specifically had a vote on that council member would now receive a stipend. And that wasn't done for the other ones, and so I think we assumed that, you know, that should have been done, but specifically A2 was getting an increase for meetings, and it wasn't.
Because the ordinance will read for elected officials, and then we have one for non-elected officials,
right,
which are employees and other board and commission members, and they run in parallel paths. So the two ordinances will define based on an ordinance, and that's the only way our clerk treasurer can pay. She has a supporting document that goes with it. Up until this past year, was there any defined actual elected position? It was basically.
But it was individually voted on for that specific council person that sat on that specific.
No, that's different. I mean, you appoint yourself on it through another body, mm-hmm. That's fine. But that any elected official that's currently on this ordinance, whether we made a change or not this year, never listed anybody beyond just the council people. It doesn't even say the council people.
Right.
But that's what I'm saying. The origination of this ordinance might be confusing as well.
Yeah.
And that's where the confusion came in.
Because we've not paid for
those positions. We presented it in 18. You were here in 18.
This is the first year that's ever been approved.
Yeah.
Never in the history of the council of the city has this two positions gotten this money, ever. And so I would say, you know, that's part of the compensation package. So I think we look at that perhaps as for salaries, because it is a significant addition to those two positions. So I think in the next 3 years, this certainly will be considered for any salary increase, because this is already a significant increase in the total compensation package.
And I appreciate that you have the dates listed of the days. I actually had requested more budget meetings than we got, partially because we had some conflicts with committee members, with council people, and when it comes to budget time, the budget committee, while it's only three members, a lot of council people like to be at all of those meetings, and it's busy people trying to work in extra meetings for that busy time, and And it, again, it just wasn't able to be worked out so that everybody could be at every meeting. It just couldn't work out.
Sure.
And
just for the record, these dates were not just budget committees, these were council meetings for the budget.
Full meetings for the budget, yeah. And what I'm saying is there had been requests for more budget committee meetings than what we were able to get on the calendar. And there may have been more time to review some of these things as they came up, had we had more meetings. Nobody loves more meetings, but
You guys control your committee meetings.
Well, I think we'll just schedule them earlier.
Yeah, we needed to work on that schedule a little bit, and I appreciate the clerk treasurer tried to work with me on that, and we were not able to get them on the calendar this last time. So we will make a greater effort to start earlier making this time.
You know, as we talked about this, we have to make sure, I mean, you guys know during budget time, we go through forests of paper, you know, and it's tough to get, I know, to make sure every one of those packets with hundreds of 50 pages in it or whatever is exactly the same, but that is where I think some of this confusion came into. You know, I mean, there was, you know, I've got every packet from the budget process, and I know that, you know, what everyone is saying is in that packet, and this is what we got, was not what was in my packet.
I would agree with you.
So it makes it almost impossible for us to all make a
how do you catch it?
Relevant, informed vote when we're voting on a different piece of paper.
Should the change have been come from us? I mean, once we've presented something, I mean, if the mayor or someone else wants to change, they can ask us to make a motion to that effect, and we usually will, of course, do that.
I asked at a public meeting on the 18th, I said, when we talked about the 2% raise, I said we were going to forego our 2% raise as full-time elected officials and adhere just to the ordinance, the ordinance salary of the boards and commissions. And
right.
I said at a public meeting.
And that's where the confusion is. So looking at the history
of
the ordinances, we've not paid for those positions. That was a confusion.
And I asked, what's council's position on that, and everybody said no. I mean, so I instructed the clerk, and that was on the 18th, so we have that ready for the 6th. Now, on the 20th, yeah, there was some confusion on the packet because there were some things about redevelopment members. We gave a raise to them because they were at the $100 for a long time. We want to make those more in line with the other boards and commissions. We moved the longevity was also put back in place and came up. And reverted back to the old system. So there were some things on there. And that's why when the October 3rd meeting came out, Chris did a good job saying, listen, this reverts back to the 6th. The 20th was some confusion there. That's why she made everybody sign the document and says, this is what we're voting on. And to make sure that there was transparency out there, there wasn't a bait and switch. And so, that was good on Christie's part to do that. So we had that in record. So, again, the process wasn't to circumvent you guys at all. We thought we had the verbal okay to go forward. The email that was contained to Christie had all of the provisions on there from the redevelopment to longevity to all this stuff. So it was a laundry list. It wasn't anything we decided in between.
But I think that's what you're saying. Don't put it in the email.
That was internally from what we got from your guys' direction from the meetings that we had with the ones who were attending those meetings. Okay, and again, that attendance was a various mixed group, okay? It wasn't until the 6th, and I think the only one that didn't come to 3rd was Scotty the 7th.
Yeah, that was another
thing. But if you looked at it, at the 18th, the 6th, the 20th, and the 3rd, there was probably a member or two that missed one of those. So there's things get lost in translation. I get it now that you guys would like to see actually highlighted the list that says, okay, in 2017 for 18, here are the points of emphasis that are being changed. Highlighted out so there's no disconcert on that.
Yeah. Especially if it's coming that night and they're seeing it for the first time, and that's what I saw that night. I got
what we're
going
to do going forward.
So it's got to be highlighted.
This is what we're going to do, even besides the highlight. At budget time and workshops, the packets will not be just, you will have to come in, I will hand you a packet, you will sign you received it, I will sign you received it, and then your document matches my document.
You're going to have to make later hours then.
And I'll make later hours because this is what's happened here. Packets were given out. Some said you got different stuff than they got on the same thing. So for that doesn't happen, and I have to have something for my record. And I understand you have your other jobs, and I understand this. But I have to make sure that the documents that you get are received from me, and you sign that you received what I have and what you have. So there's no problem. Because what happens is we have someone downstairs that presents all these packets together and gets them out. There was some changes made and things did happen. So I don't want this going forward. In the future, that's how I will set it up in my office so you would get them. So this cannot and will not happen again. I will highlight, I will put it in red ink, I will highlight, and then I'll make sure that you, Scott, get the copy I have. You'll sign my copy and your copy. Bob, you'll sign your copy and my copy. Every councilman, if I have to run it to your house, I have no problem with that.
But we're going to sit there and go through every page of every budget document to make sure we have the same copies?
No, we can't have this happen again.
Agreed.
Say, you got something different. I have to have some way to make sure everything's getting the same document.
A version number would be sufficient. A best practice that we have in the industry is that when you have one version of a budget and then it goes to another version, which we had several versions, is we just get an addendum to say this is what is different so that we don't have to go page by page and everyone else doesn't have to go page by page. This is what's different than
sure.
the other version
right.
too.
Paragraph
and I think we've had that in the past and maybe we just kind of...
Because I don't think there's enough time to go through and double back on packets.
But then what in the future if it happens again that Chad, you say because...
Well, then I think on the packet say A, and put all A's on the pages or something. On B's, this is all the B1, B2, B3. So that when I look at it, this is the A version, this is the B version, this is the C version. And just put a letter in front of the numbers so I can quickly say, oh, I got all three versions. That's what I would do. And rather than have all the numbers and we're trying to figure out, well, which one are you on? Well, I'm on A1. Oh, okay, well, that's got to be this one. Because they're all numbered the same, and then you're thinking, well, what are they on? And I even look over and think, what page is he on? Is it in this one? But if we letter them, that's the letter packet, there should be absolutely no confusion. Mm-hmm. Each page should have A1, A2, B2, and B3.
Again, this was your first year of the budget. I think I told you after the first year you're going to be a seasoned veteran and not putting packets together and stuff like that. I think as long as you know that what you're passing out there is the seven same version, seven of them, that's all you need to be confident with, because that's the seven version that went out. If somebody within your, again, I'm not going to tell you that your office, you're doing a good job down there. Have the last look. If you got A doing some of the budget, B's doing it, have them both version you, and you get the last look and say, you know what, that's the packet. You sign off on it. We know that you sign off on it. We should be good. Okay. And then if take Andrew's put an order there, would be, if it's a different version number, just we know what version number it's the most current version. I think once we do that, let's not work harder. Let's just work smarter on this. And
yeah, if she signed off on it, I would take it that it's been looked at.
So she started looking at that this year with it. She did do on that email letter. Here's the highlight. Not highlight, but here's the changes. And there was changes.
Did a letter to everybody.
But I think what they would, they need to see the highlighted. Hey, listen, that's the first thing I'm gonna look at. Check. I get that because there are
you
a thousand.
Kind of
I mean,
that's
a giant task. I mean, I'm not.
Especially around budget time, we go through that stuff so fast because
we live it every day.
You're living
so
it. Right.
And that would
take
10 hours. We want to get done in like 2-3 hours. We go through so fast. We all miss it. We all miss stuff.
You guys do weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks of constant budget, and it is running through your head. And that's why you look at the numbers and go, oh, you know, 60 is the parks or whatever. Can't do that. And I've been set up here 10 or 12 years. So it isn't. It isn't the high level. I mean, we know it's important. We want to do a good job. We really do. But it is not on the top of our heads the way it is that you guys are doing it.
As a full-time.
There is a feature if you're using Microsoft Word. That usually, when you do contract work, you know, lawyers, there's a version or tracking, change tracking feature where it'll automatically highlight anything that you've changed and show the deletions and do all the old-fashioned, back in the typewriter days when they cross stuff out and
so you don't have to hand do it, they can actually.
Yeah, so they can just you go change stuff, and it'll appear on the page. You can say, print it with that. And so that's, the lawyers pass stuff back and forth to your two companies. They can
I trust you guys to figure out something that works so that it's not burdensome, but it's still helpful. And if whatever we can do to help make that happen, I don't want it to become burdensome with, you know, crises, hours involved.
Do you have that feature, Adam, in an app that you can highlight stuff if there's a change or should?
Yeah, actually, Chris is right on. All the Microsoft stuff will do that, show the addendums
okay,
on.
So you can help.
Now, part of what I believe you guys have received, everybody on the council, a letter last week or last month's meeting about the using your email in the OneDrive. The clerk's office has the ability to, as they save that file to their drive, you will have that instantaneously. So you don't have to wait for prints and packets and whatnot. So how that's utilized was in those instructions. I'd be more than happy to sit down with whoever wants to, you know, see that feature in a, you know, a larger scale and how to use it properly. But I think that would correct quite a bit of the issues that you're discussing, to have that at the same time everybody else does. So again, with the Word and Excel, you'll still be able to see the tracking of the changes. Everything will be time-stamped as well, so you know they were uploaded. You will have them at the same exact time as everybody else. So I know they've been testing it. The other departments or the other boards and commissions have been using it for a couple years now, and it seems to be working.
I'm not saying Christy's doing bad. In fact, Christy's doing a very good job. We're just saying, could you please help us, Christy, with the mountain of paperwork that we have made a mess out of on our sitting on my guest room in my house?
Good way to put it, exactly.
Yeah, except just a version number, I think, would be like a great first start, just so we know that we have version 4 of something, that I just grabbed version 1 off the bed and came in with that, and I'm looking at the wrong version. And, you know, Scott can explain to me that you got the wrong version.
And we're working harder with her and I to come up with solutions to get the packet back to you sooner. So over the holidays here, we took this, we knew this stuff was
important.
We kind of found out that we don't send our, we mail stuff out now. It doesn't go to Gary, it goes to Chicago now.
Yeah.
And if it holds up 2 or 3 days, which we typically figure, we put something in the mail here locally, you're going to get the next day. We find it's 4 or 5 days delay. So we are going to try to eliminate those things. And packet's ready. We moved the Board of Works meetings, so that way that you have a 10-day lag at the end of the month, so that way anything that needs to go on there, we can work with Christy to get that packet put out together, get it to expand faster and sooner. So we don't want to be in a position where we're rushing to where our office doesn't get the things that Christy and I or the departments can't get, we're rushing. And we all know if we rush, we make mistakes. Okay, we don't want to eliminate that. We want you guys to feel comfortable, we want you guys to feel confident, we want you guys to understand that the things that you're getting here, that it's based on your guys' needs and wants and goals. Okay? That's been our guide from the day when we went up here. So,
thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
And Anthony, thank you. I got my packet last night for planning.
Perfect.
That's been coming faster, too, or earlier. I appreciate it.
Okay, we've been here a long time. I know we got reports. Greg, anything from your office? No. Diana?
Just 2 short announcements. I just want to thank the sponsors for the kids' New Year's Eve party, Office Square Sports Academy, Alpine Water, Beck's Chrome Bakery, Rosati's, Domino's, Carriage Court, and the Toys. And then your new event starting tomorrow. Midweek meetings with the mayor will be at 8 a.m. at
Pabst's
Restaurant in
Jewel Blossom. Also, put this on your calendar too. This date is confirmed. March 21st is going to be the State of the City. We normally did that with the State of the Region of Maryville. We are separating ourselves from that and staying here locally. It's going to be at Whitehawk. That gives us more time to really dive into the city's progress versus being on time constraint because you have to share time. So we can control the vehicle a bit more at that location. There'll be events, there'll be things that people can buy tables, they can buy seats, so it's going to be a regular neutral type thing for our community. We're also going to be working with our redevelopment commission. We're going to be featuring 5 businesses that partner with redevelopment and kind of showcase the things that they did with the money to make their businesses bigger and nicer with facade programs. And then we're going to announce a winner that night based on a vote on who did the most. But that's going to draw people to come see and also introduce how other businesses can come in and partner with the RDC and do facade programs or grants to enhance their businesses. Perfect example is we spent about $35,000-$40,000 on Main Streets through the RDC, and you get over $1 million in return. That's a story that's been told. There's a lot of life up and down North Main Street now. A lot of vacant buildings or refurbished buildings. We want to share that story, let other people know that there's opportunities out there. Give a little more time for our department heads to discuss what they've accomplished and do it under our time frame. So March 21st begins at 5:30 is registration, and then I believe dinner will be at 7 o'clock.
February 6th council meeting, we will announce the three contest winners for the photo contest for the statues, and we'll announce the three winners for the scavenger hunt. So that'll be at our next council meeting. And then I didn't know if we could have a parks and a building meeting. If Diane, did you get the hours that we could make committee meetings for those in January sometime?
You said Mondays are better for you guys?
Yeah, I think Mondays, obviously, even before RDC Mondays are good. And then Scott, Laura, and I are on the park, so if you guys have started or you'd like to jump in on the, the band show over there.
We're hoping to get some tomorrow, first draft rendering. Very early stage.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay, that's it. Thank you so much.
Any other business needs before the council? Just announcing that the next scheduled meeting will be February 6, 2017. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All fair than I do.